Storm world, hurricanes, politics, and the battle over global warming, by Chris Mooney, narrated by Lloyd James. Copyright 2007 by Chris Mooney. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Harcourt Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2007 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Meteorology has ever been an apple of contention, as if the violent commotions of the atmosphere induced a sympathetic effect on the minds of those who have attempted to study them. Smithsonian Secretary Joseph Henry, U.S. Patent Office, Annual Report, Agriculture, 1858. Prologue. 6229 Memphis Street. On the day after Christmas 2005, 4 months after Hurricane Katrina swamped it with polluted water, the neighborhood of Lakeview, New Orleans, showed only the faintest signs of life. Piles of debris sat on each curbside. Loose dogs roamed the streets, and the vegetation everywhere was dead. The houses remained almost entirely uninhabited. Some were now hollow shells, gutted by work crews. Others still sported interiors that looked as though they had been ransacked by the creature from the Black Lagoon. Collapsed floors, stinking refrigerators, disintegrating piles of paper, and huge tapestries of mold on the walls. My mother's house was one of these. A tree had crashed across the backyard, knocking down a flimsy fence. A sewing machine protruded from beneath a pile of boards. On the side of the house, rescue crews had painted a red mark. Beneath it had lain the carcass of mules, a feral cat my mother had been feeding. Inside, a clock still ticked, and the smoke alarm let out occasional bleeps. The floors were spongy, especially in the hallway, which had become a graveyard of congealing paper after a bookcase collapsed. Everything was caked with mud and grime. Substantially damaged is how the city bureaucrats, with their knack for understatement, described it. Yet despite countless scenes like this, many residents of Lakeview had vowed to return and rebuild their neighborhood. They had grown up in this safe, conservative, Catholic community and couldn't imagine living anywhere else. Outside one battered church, a sign read, "Behold, I am making all things new." And that's just what these New Orleanians plan to do. "Re-New Orleans," reads the popular T-shirt in town, capturing a passionate sense of devotion to the city and its restoration. That devotion came across journalistically on Christmas Day 2005, the day before my mother, sister, and I ventured into Lakeview to see the destruction firsthand, when the local Times-Picayune ran a front-page feature article entitled, "What Will New Orleans Look Like 5 Years From Now?" Starry-eyed plans for light rail, raised houses, and new green spaces were described. But my eyes lingered on a sentence dropped in toward the end. "Surrounding it all is a dependable Category 3 levee system." That hardly sounded like planning for the worst-case scenario. Katrina was a mid-range Category 3 storm on the Saffir-Simpson hurricane scale, with maximum sustained winds estimated at about 120 miles per hour when it made its final landfall near the Louisiana-Mississippi border. Winds experienced in New Orleans weren't even at Category 3 strength, since the storm didn't hit the city directly. It missed. Knowing this, I worried in late 2005 that those charged with rebuilding New Orleans might be paying inadequate attention to the possibility of an even worse hurricane disaster at some point in the future. Not only could a stronger storm come in any season, considerable, if hotly disputed, evidence suggests we may be entering a world in which, thanks to human-induced global warming, the average hurricane itself becomes more powerful and deadly. The threat to New Orleans, and to other vulnerable coastal cities like Miami, Tampa Bay, Houston, Charleston, Providence, New York, and even possibly San Diego, could be steadily rising, along with the sea levels that further amplify hurricane risks. Out of that sense of concern, which grew more seasoned and nuanced as I traveled to scientific conferences and learned more about hurricanes, arose this book. You might think of it as a homegrown New Orleans science writer's idiosyncratic way of coping. Certainly it is no polemic, no work of alarmism. At least as I write these words in late 2006, Our scientific understanding of the hurricane-climate relationship remains too incomplete to justify such an approach. Instead, as I examined this ongoing debate through the lens of my own concern, I saw staring back at me the story of how a largely unsuspecting group of scientists had been drawn by politics, the media, the weather, and the history of meteorology itself into a situation of tense conflict more typical of political operatives and opposition researchers, although the scientists, by and large, acquitted themselves more admirably. Still, this book was inspired by thoughts of my family and friends who lived or who are still living in New Orleans, and is dedicated to them. So, for that matter, was an article I published on May 23, 2005, some 100 days before Katrina formed southeast of the Bahamas, entitled, "Thinking Big About Hurricanes. It's Time to Get Serious About Saving New Orleans." But while the piece ricocheted around the internet after Katrina, it went largely unnoticed at the time of its publication, like many similar calls of warning. That's all past, though. Those remaining in my hometown must consider their future, rather than what might once have been done. I only hope that when they do so, they will include global warming as part of the picture, precisely because of the considerable scientific uncertainty about just how severe its consequences will be. At the outset, let me offer a critical point of clarification. Global warming did not cause Hurricane Katrina or any other weather disaster. Or, to put it more precisely, we just can't say scientifically that global warming either does or does not cause individual weather events. Why? As the climate scientist writers of realclimate.org, the leading global warming blog, observed after Katrina, "We only have one Earth, and it will follow only one of an infinite number of possible weather sequences. It is impossible to know whether or not this event would have taken place if we had not increased the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere as much as we have. Weather events will always result from a combination of deterministic factors, including greenhouse gas forcing or slow natural climate cycles, and stochastic factors, pure chance." To explain the difference between weather and climate, realclimate.org used the analogy of rolling a die. You never know what's going to come up on any given roll, but over time and across many rolls, you can get a very good sense of the odds and thus whether or not the die is loaded. With this caveat out of the way, we can get to the central issue: whether global warming will strengthen or otherwise change hurricanes in general, even if it can't explain the absolute existence, attributes, or behavior of any single one of them. To determine the answer, scientists have to consider what they think they know about hurricanes and why they intensify, pore over the statistics they've compiled on global hurricanes, summed across the various ocean basins where these storms occur, and then determine whether their theory aligns with the data. There the debate commences. Resolving it on a purely scientific level would be challenging enough to begin with, and that's without the media klieglights, the brazen political acts of scientific suppression, and the storms slamming the coasts. Introduction. The Party Line. The worst Atlantic hurricane season on record still hadn't ended when the American Geophysical Union held its fall meeting in San Francisco in December 2005. 12,000 scientists packed themselves into the Moscone Center, the city's space-age mall of a conference facility, for lectures on topics such as the massive 2004 Sumatra-Andaman earthquake and the tsunami that it generated, the data beamed from NASA's Mars rovers, and the Cassini spacecraft. Many of the presentations were being given on the center's upper levels, and security guards had to police the towering escalators just to prevent overcrowding. MIT hurricane theorist Carrie Emanuel arrived on this scene riding a swell of fame that few researchers ever experience. A short man with striking blue-green eyes and a slightly surprised smile, Emanuel had just seen his latest work featured in a Time magazine cover story, and would soon find it rated, along with the work of several colleagues, the top science story of the year by Discover. He was averaging 5 to 10 media calls per week. Later, he would be named one of the 100 most influential people of 2006, once again by Time. At the American Geophysical Union meeting, Emmanuel had been slated to speak following another of Time's most influential, NASA's James Hansen, the nation's best-known climate scientist, and the man sometimes dubbed the father of global warming. The science presented at the average American Geophysical Union meeting features a heavy helping of catastrophe. Tornadoes, volcanoes, earthquakes, tsunamis. The proceedings offer a subject roster that Hollywood disaster movie directors would appreciate. But that December, the cause of destruction at the front of everyone's mind was the strongest and deadliest storm on Earth, a meteorological monstrosity capable of churning out as much power as all the world's electricity generators combined. The tropical cyclone, typhoon, or as we call it in the United States, the hurricane. Katrina had wiped out New Orleans just a few months earlier. On the day of Emmanuel's talk, Tuesday, December 6th, Hurricane Epsilon whirled in on the North Atlantic some 600 miles southwest of the Azores. The aimless cyclone had already executed a full loop, completely reversing its original westward trajectory, and now began a southwest turn. Epsilon wasn't a particularly strong storm. Its maximum sustained winds peaked at about 85 miles per hour, and it never seriously threatened land. Author's definition. Maximum sustained winds are defined as the highest one-minute wind at a height of 10 meters, 33 feet, from the surface. In a hurricane over water, for obvious reasons, this quantity is more often inferred, or estimated, than directly measured. But it was stubborn. Moreover, Epsilon had the distinction of being only the sixth hurricane ever recorded as occurring in the Atlantic during the month of December, as well as the 27th storm of a seemingly never-ending season. So never-ending, in fact, that forecasters had resorted to Greek letters after pre-assigned storm names, like Katrina, Rita, Wilma, ran out. At the National Hurricane Center in Miami, a steel-reinforced concrete bunker of a building on the campus of Florida International University that was built to withstand Category 5 hurricanes and whose roof bristles with dishes and antennae, the experts awaited Epsilon's demise. With it, they hoped, would come the official end to the devastating 2005 season, and more than a few sighs of relief. Traditionally, the hurricane season in the Atlantic Basin, which comprises the North Atlantic, the Caribbean Sea, and the Gulf of Mexico, begins on June 1st and ends on November 30th. In 2005, however, nature had already toppled such bookends. And now, despite days of forecasts predicting steady weakening, Epsilon had held on to hurricane strength and even put on a few small bursts of intensification. "I have run out of things to say, and this one will be short," wrote Cuban-born forecaster Lizion Avila in an exasperated 4 a.m. discussion of the storm's progress, written in the all-caps and heavily elliptical style that remains the standard for weather communiques. "Epsilon appears to still be a hurricane, but just barely," wrote forecaster Richard Nabb 6 hours later. "The end is in sight," echoed forecaster James Franklin at 10 that evening. "It really, really is." By the time Epsilon finally died down, having been for 5 days a hurricane, a December record, Carrie Emanuel had generated a tempest of his own in San Francisco. Speaking before a crowd of hundreds in one of the largest of the Moscone Center's high-ceilinged conference rooms, the normally cautious and apolitical scientist fired a shot straight at the bosses of government forecasters like Avila, Nabb, and Franklin. Earlier in the day, the audience had heard the wiry Midwestern climatologist James Hansen warn that global warming could cause the disintegration of the Greenland and West Antarctic ice sheets, triggering rises in sea level sufficient to inundate many of the globe's heavily inhabited coastal areas. After a break, Emmanuel launched into a seemingly typical scientific talk, constructed out of PowerPoint images rather than paragraphs. He flashed slides demonstrating that although global tropical cyclone numbers did not show any obvious trend up or down, averaging about 80 to 90 per year in the world's six regularly active ocean basins, storms in the Atlantic and the Northwest Pacific had grown stronger and longer lasting over the past several decades, closely tracking a trend of rising temperatures at the surface of the oceans. To explain this phenomenon, Emmanuel then introduced a series of equations. These probably meant little to the non-scientists in the audience, but to specialists capable of reading the equations as if they were sentences, the message was clear. Increasing hurricane strength is linked to human enhancement of the greenhouse effect. The Earth's atmosphere contains certain gases, such as carbon dioxide and water vapor, that have a very important property. They absorb infrared or long-wave radiation and also emit it in all directions. As a result, these gases play a crucial role in regulating the flux of energy to and from the planet. Even as the sun's rays heat the Earth's surface, the Earth also emits radiation in the infrared part of the spectrum, with a longer wavelength than that of visible light. The greenhouse gases then absorb some of that outgoing heat radiation, which might otherwise escape into space, warm up, and emit more radiation back down toward the lower atmosphere and the Earth's surface. In the process, these gases keep our planet much warmer than it would be if it lacked an atmosphere. Through industrial processes such as smokestack and tailpipe emissions, humans have been steadily increasing the concentration of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. As a result, we've caused additional warming of the Earth's surface, lower atmosphere, and oceans. And that's where hurricanes come into the picture. Since these storms draw their power from the energy stored in tropical ocean waves, warmer seas should, everything else being equal, make them stronger. This hypothesis that hurricanes would intensify in a warmer world had been around at least since 1987, published in that year by Emmanuel himself. Theoretically based predictions, however, don't hit you in the gut like hard data. And by 2005, Emmanuel was going beyond such predictions. He was saying, "It's actually happening." Anyone could see Emmanuel's findings had potentially enormous implications. When they strike land, and especially when they strike places where people live, strong hurricanes cause dramatically more destruction than weak ones. Hurricane damage doesn't simply increase linearly with increasing wind speed. Rather, it goes up much more steeply, in part because damaged structures, for example, the roof torn off a house, become missiles flung into other structures. It has been estimated that a landfalling Category 4 or 5 hurricane, with maximum sustained winds greater than 131 miles per hour, causes 64 times as much destruction as a Category 1 storm, winds from 74 to 95 miles per hour, and 256 times as much as a mere tropical storm, winds up to and including 73 miles per hour. Emmanuel was telling his audience that we're helping transform more and more hurricanes into monstrous city smashers. If true, the discovery would rank as one of the most dramatic manifestations yet of human-caused global warming, and perhaps the most terrifying. Emmanuel's scientific message was breathtaking enough, but he took it farther. He showed a slide featuring a statement from the man who was then director of the National Hurricane Center, Max Mayfield, asserting that the dramatic upswing in Atlantic hurricane activity since the year 1995 sprang from natural fluctuations and was not enhanced substantially by global warming. This, Emmanuel somewhat derisively dubbed the party line of the Bush administration's National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, a branch of the Department of Commerce that includes the Hurricane Center as well as numerous other scientific and forecasting branches, ranging from the National Climate Data Center to the National Marine Fisheries Service. In his next slide, Emmanuel juxtaposed the NOAA party line with a statement he attributed to an unnamed agency scientist. "I have been told not to speak with reporters about the connection between global warming and hurricanes without prior permission from NOAA management. According to Emmanuel, the unidentified scientist worked at the Geophysical Fluid Dynamics Laboratory, GFDL, in Princeton, New Jersey, a hub for research on climate change, employing sophisticated computer models of the atmosphere and the oceans. On the one hand, scientists at GFDL have pioneered a cutting-edge hurricane model that the forecasters in Miami rely heavily upon in their day-to-day storm tracking. But GFDL researchers have also taken a much longer view, producing a series of studies similarly suggesting that global warming will increase the strength of the average hurricane over the course of the 21st century. Some in the audience had heard stories about NOAA stifling the ability of its scientists to speak freely to the media about hurricanes and global warming, or about global warming in general. They had also seen an agency publication claim a consensus among its hurricane specialists on this question, asserting that they accepted what Emmanuel had defined as the party line. So the audience was primed for what came next. Emmanuel, almost in passing, stated his opinion that NOAA really ought to stop censoring its scientists. It was antithetical to science, which thrives on the open exchange of ideas. It had to stop. The statement was political, but it wasn't delivered in a mode of political oratory. Emmanuel didn't bang his fist on the podium, much less raise it. That's not his style. He simply resumed his presentation, neatly bracketing his political remark with hard science. Nevertheless, Emmanuel's brief suspension of scientific etiquette had struck a chord. The room erupted with applause. If Emmanuel had issued a verbal challenge to the government's hurricane forecasting community, The Atlantic would soon issue yet another meteorological one. In his final dispatch on Epsilon, Lizion Avila had declared, "I hope this is the end of the long-lasting 2005 hurricane season." It wasn't. Several weeks later, the ocean and atmosphere served up Tropical Storm Zeta, noteworthy not for its strength, but for its timing. The storm formed in the central Atlantic, some 675 miles northwest of the Cape Verde Islands on December 30th, fully a month after the season's official endpoint. Although the atmosphere seems to want to develop tropical storms ad nauseum, quipped forecaster James Franklin, when Zeta appeared, the calendar will shortly put an end to the use of the Greek alphabet to name them. The calendar did not put an end to Zeta, however. Like Epsilon, the storm didn't die when it was supposed to. Zeta never became a hurricane, but it clung tenaciously to life. Frustrating and confounding forecasts, the storm stayed organized until January 6, 2006, in the process shattering a few last seasonal hurricane records. In his farewell to the storm and the 2005 season, during which he and his fellow storm trackers had collectively put in hundreds of overtime hours, forecaster Stacy Stewart expressed his amazement and exhaustion alike. "I suppose it is only fitting that the record-breaking 2005 Atlantic hurricane season ends with a record-breaking storm. Today, Zeta surpassed 1954 Alice No. 2 as the longest-lived tropical cyclone to form in December and cross over into the next year. Zeta was also the longest-lived January tropical cyclone. In addition, Zeta resulted in the 2005 season having the largest accumulated cyclone energy, or ACE, surpassing the 1950 season. So, until the 2006 season begins, unless Zeta somehow makes an unlikely miracle comeback, this is the National Hurricane Center signing off for 2005. Finally." It was, at long last, the end of a staggering hurricane year. And it was a beginning, the launch of a full-scale scientific and political battle over the relationship between hurricanes and global warming that would bring out the best and occasionally the worst in two groups of researchers whose areas of expertise overlap so much that they might be considered siblings: climate scientists on the one hand and hurricane and weather forecasters on the other. This is their story, first set in its historical context, and then told as it unfolded across the dramatic hurricane years of 2004, 2005, and 2006. It's a narrative of scientific understanding, developing in real time, in all of its inevitable messiness, under immense political pressure, and in the full glare of media scrutiny. Scientists, like hurricanes, do extraordinary things at high wind speeds. Such conflicts may bring out their human side, but also inspire their very best work. To grasp the roots of the present dispute, however, we must first glance back to the Great American Storm controversy of the 19th century, which featured a divide between scientists similar in many respects to the one that exists today. And we must visit the heroic post-World War II storm-flying era of hurricane research, when the mentors of the scientists embroiled in the current hurricane global warming argument conducted their most important studies. This history reveals how long-standing personal and methodological schisms among meteorologists have, like a hurricane's steering currents, helped guide us to the present moment, and how they explain, at least as much as present-day political alignments, why the hurricane climate debate became so charged, and even at times, venomous. Scientists disagree constantly, of course. That's not news. But rarely has there been quite as much on the line. If we're really making the deadliest storms on Earth still deadlier, it will represent one of humanity's all-time greatest foot-shooting episodes. Short of a collapse of the Greenland or West Antarctic ice sheets, it's hard to imagine many hypothesized manifestations of global warming more likely to shock the public or to generate a call to action. The 1992 United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change announced the goal of preventing dangerous anthropogenic interference with the climate system. And while the term dangerous was never explicitly defined, surely increasing the intensity of the average hurricane would fit the bill. With stakes such as these, and with special interests on both sides eager to spin the latest science to their advantage, the circulation of ideas in the hurricane global warming argument could easily attain gale force. Add to this an administration that has shown a strong tendency to suppress or twist inconvenient scientific information pertaining to global warming, an historically rooted and methodologically grounded rivalry between two groups of scientists studying the same meteorological phenomenon from very different vantage points, and a towering figure of American hurricane science, William Gray of Colorado State University, who rejects entirely the notion that humans have been causing substantial global warming, and whose students hold positions of great scientific influence, and you have the makings of the perfect hurricane. Part 1. Warming and Storming. This seems to be a rule in our science. Progress is impeded by want of meteorological knowledge on the part of the theoreticians, and by a too poor mathematical training of weathermen. Swedish meteorologist Tor Bergeron, Methods in Scientific Weather Analysis and Forecasting, 1959. Chapter 1. Chimneys and Whirlpools. Communities and nations, and especially their ships and navies, have been ravaged by hurricanes from time immemorial. The ancient Mayans, who dubbed their storm god Hunrakan, wisely built their cities inland from the coasts. The 13th century Japanese blessed the kamikaze, divine wind, for not once but twice wiping out the invading fleets of Mongol ruler Kublai Khan. In 1502, during his fourth and final voyage to the New World, the fleet of Christopher Columbus weathered a hurricane while docked at the island of Hispaniola in the Caribbean Sea. Yet beyond scattered accounts from mariners who had lived through storms they described as whirlwinds, and ancient images from Caribbean civilizations whose iconic depictions of the storm god featured counterclockwise spirals, hurricanes remained almost entirely mysterious up through the 18th century. It wasn't until 1743 that Benjamin Franklin first conceived of storms in general as collectives of wind and clouds traveling together over large areas, an insight that may well mark the beginning of modern meteorology. In the early 19th century, scientific understanding finally began to penetrate the storm vortices that form over tropical oceans. Yet even then, researchers did not always see their work as an attempt to explain the nature of one particular type of storm, rather than that of all storms, or at least the majority of them. An accurate meteorological taxonomy of large-scale cyclonic storm systems, one that distinguished the warm core cyclones of the tropics from the more massive cold core or extratropical cyclones of the middle and higher latitudes, which frequently dump snow rather than torrential rain, and whose energy derives from the clash of warm tropical and cold polar air along a front, only arrived later. In part because of this vagueness about the central object of study, in part because meteorology itself and the massive data gathering needed to support it had not yet become fully established and institutionalized, and in part because modern standards governing scientific debate and dispute did not yet exist, the so-called American storm controversy of the 19th century raged on for decades. The squabble had its origins in a simple set of observations taken following a devastating hurricane. By the end, it had grown into an international conflict, implicating the very nature of science, as the debate's two chief disputants split over whether storm studies should be rooted in the careful collection of data and observations, or in theory-based deduction from the laws of physics. The divide between these two approaches is conducting research. As the British physicist Ernest Rutherford famously put it, all science is either physics or stamp collecting, has long dogged meteorology. It reemerges at the heart of the current conflict over the relationship between hurricanes and global warming, a debate in which longtime hurricane specialist William Gray, who trained as a traditional map-reading weather forecaster, holds out for data-driven approaches, even as his more mathematically inclined critics, like Emmanuel, apply data as well as theory, equations, and computer models to the problem. In Rutherford's admittedly biased and overly crude classification scheme, Gray would be the stamp collector, Emmanuel, the physicist. In the 19th century, just as today then, meteorologists who adopted different styles of research often arrived at different conclusions. The American storm controversy thus prefigured today's battle over hurricanes and climate, as well as shaping the development of knowledge about hurricanes more generally. As we'll see, the controversy's resolution shows that scientific debates, whether over the influence of global warming on hurricanes or simply over the nature of storms, can be settled by the discovery of new data, the development of new theories, or some combination of both. The American storm saga began in 1831, when William Redfield, an amateur and self-taught weather researcher who ran a steamboat business and dabbled in a variety of scientific pursuits on the side, published a very important study in the American Journal of Science and Arts. The work presented a range of evidence suggesting that storms, and especially hurricanes, are giant rotating bodies whose winds move much more rapidly around the storm center than the storm itself moves over land or water. The central data that Redfield used to substantiate this view came from his own experience 10 years earlier of the devastation left behind by the Great Norfolk and Long Island Hurricane of 1821, which delivered a direct hit to New York City. Even at low tide, the storm flooded the Battery and overflowed wharves, and then proceeded to rampage across New England. Shortly after it passed by, Redfield took a journey by foot through the countryside and examined a large number of trees that had been felled by it. Amid the destruction, he detected a pattern. Trees in the northwestern part of Connecticut and nearby Massachusetts had been prostrated towards the southeast by winds blowing hard from the northwest, Redfield observed. Yet in central Connecticut, the winds at the same time seemed to have blown in the opposite direction, toward the northwest, and fruit, trees, corn, etc., had fallen in this direction. How could two locations within the same state have experienced such different winds? Redfield saw only one solution. This storm, he wrote, was exhibited in the form of a great whirlwind. With this discovery, Redfield launched an influential career of storm research that culminated when he became the first president of the American Association for the Advancement of Science in 1848. Throughout that career, Redfield hewed to a strict empiricist methodology, or at least so he claimed. He collected a large array of data on storms from ships' logs and their captains, from eyewitnesses who'd been present when storms made landfall, and from other sources. When it came to theorizing, however, Redfield aligned himself with the 17th century English thinker Francis Bacon, who had described science as an inductive process of reasoning in which open-minded investigators painstakingly gather observations about the natural world and only then seek to generalize from them, rather than beginning with a commitment to any particular theory or interpretation. Scientists' rhetoric about methodology can diverge from their actual practices, however, and Redfield did in fact have a theory about the origins of hurricanes and other rotary storms, such as tornadoes. He considered these phenomena the atmospheric equivalent of water in a pot being stirred, meaning that whirlwinds and whirlpools were very similar phenomena in his mind. The analogy between the tides and currents of the ocean and of the atmosphere is perhaps sufficient for our argument, Redfield wrote. In turn, Redfield described the behavior of atmospheric tides as mechanical gravitation. His theoretical account wasn't particularly convincing, however, and later, one of his own supporters faulted him for violating his principles by advancing it. The strength of Redfield's argument lay in his data. He soon attracted a group of allies who supported and tried to extend his interpretation of storms, both by gathering together more observations and by applying them practically to ensure safe navigation for ships at sea. Redfield's work had a considerable influence on British researcher William Reid, who experienced a deadly hurricane in Barbados in 1831 and later confirmed the rotational nature of storms with much additional data, and on Henry Pittington, a former ship commander and president of Marine Courts of Inquiry in Calcutta, India. Pittington coined the term cyclone, meaning coil of a snake, and published a book for sailors detailing what he called the law of storms, which provided tips on how to steer your vessel clear of a hurricane's most powerful winds. In the northern hemisphere, hurricane winds whirl in a counterclockwise direction. In the southern hemisphere, it's the opposite. Redfield, Pittington, and their supporters didn't understand the true reason for this. That would come later. But they recognized the value of such knowledge for safe navigation. In the northern hemisphere, whichever direction a hurricane is heading, its right front quadrant will be the most dangerous for a ship, since the winds in this quadrant will have the storm's own forward momentum behind them. In the southern hemisphere, the reverse is the case. Pittington, therefore, counseled ships' captains to determine the direction in which the storm was moving and steer for its weakest quadrant. For much like the work of today's Miami-based hurricane forecasters, the Redfield-Reed-Pittington School of Storm Studies had a strongly practical orientation. The research focused on protecting mariners from having their masts torn off by shrieking hurricane winds and their ships engulfed by massive hurricane waves. This was not so much about scientific theory as it was about saving lives. In his 1848 book, Pittington even announced his intention to write in what he called the familiar terms of common sailor language, eschewing more scientific forms of expression. Yet even as some navigators began putting Redfield's findings about rotating storms into practice, James Pollard Espy, the so-called Storm King, denounced them as sheer bunkum. A theorist and popularizer who in 1842 became the de facto national meteorologist with the U.S. War Department and later worked at the Smithsonian Institution, Espy had been influenced by the English chemist John Dalton, who experimented with the properties of gases and derived the first modern atomic theory. This background led him to a very different view of storms from Redfield's. Espy highlighted the key role of what we now call latent heat in storm development, and then used this insight to forge a theory with a strong thermodynamic emphasis, one that placed phase changes of molecules of water, most centrally evaporation and condensation, at its very center. Today, the concept of latent or hidden heat seems almost intuitive. In the process of evaporation, heat drawn from the environment allows energized molecules of water to escape from their liquid phase. A commonly used analogy is that of getting out of a swimming pool or the shower. As water evaporates from your skin, you feel a chill, because heat is being pulled into the air and away from your body. The heat has now taken the form of latent heat and become locked within the molecules of water vapor. It will be released again into the air as sensible heat, heat you can actually feel, when the vapor condenses back into liquid water. Espy combined this notion of latent heat release, or as he called it, latent caloric, with the atmospheric process of convection, the transfer of heat upward by rising currents of air, and used it to explain the formation of clouds and rain. When the sun heats the Earth's surface, warm air rises, carrying heat as well as water vapor aloft. Indeed, the more water vapor the air contains, the more buoyant it becomes, and thus, the more likely it is to rise in the first place. As the air rises through the atmosphere, it experiences a drop in pressure as the cumulative weight of air molecules from above diminishes. The same thing that happens as you ascend a mountain. So, the air expands and cools. When it cools sufficiently, the water vapor that it contains begins to condense into droplets of water or change into ice crystals, which organize into clouds. In the process, latent heat gets released, once again becoming sensible heat and thus further enhancing the ascent of warm, moist air. Soon, a thunderstorm may emerge. With this account, Espy articulated several key principles underlying the behavior of thunderstorms, and therefore of hurricanes, which are gigantic rotating groups of thunderclouds. And he made a major step toward transforming meteorology from a purely observational science, dominated by diarists and data collectors like Redfield, into one that sought to establish universal theories based upon the behavior of heat and gases. If Redfield envisioned storms as analogous to whirlpools, you could say Espy viewed them as more akin to chimneys. And he applied his ideas about latent heat and convection to all storms in all situations, further asserting that storm winds rush straight inward from all directions to a central point or region where the air pressure is lowest. This led him to dismiss entirely Redfield's arguments about rotating winds. For Espy, all storms were the same, and his theory captured them perfectly. Given this position, it was probably inevitable that Espy would get drawn into a spat with Redfield over the nature of storms. Their conflict began in the mid-1830s and soon degenerated into personal attacks and accusations of underhanded data manipulation. Writing in 1835, Espy described Redfield's views as so anomalous and inconsistent with received theories that I hesitate to put entire confidence in them and shall continue to doubt until I have the most certain evidence of the facts. In a bile-filled 1839 rebuttal, Redfield countered, I did not anticipate so complete an evasion of all the distinguishing points at issue, and so barren an effort at confusing and mystifying the most distinct phenomena of this storm, as is manifested by Espy's present examination. Espy, Redfield charged, in typically Baconian language, labored under the bias of a preconceived hypothesis. Ultimately, the highly public conflict between these two scientists, amplified by the participation of a third scientist, the volatile Robert Hare, who thought Espy and Redfield were both wrong and ascribed storm formation to electricity, resonated overseas. British scientists sided with Redfield, the French with Espy. The battle helped spur the growth of American meteorology, as the Smithsonian Institution set up a national network of weather observers, as well as a smaller network situated along newly established telegraph lines, to help resolve it. For many years, however, the dispute dragged on, its participants refusing to concede any ground. Perhaps the most memorable commentary on the controversy came from Joseph Henry, the first secretary of the Smithsonian, who observed that meteorology has ever been an apple of contention, as if the violent commotions of the atmosphere induced a sympathetic effect on the minds of those who have attempted to study them. Henry suspected future researchers would see that both Espy and Redfield had grasped a part of the truth, and that's precisely what happened. We now know Redfield was correct to describe many storms, especially hurricanes and tornadoes, as whirlwinds. The theory of atmospheric tides that he invoked to explain his observations, on the other hand, had little to recommend it. Espy's basic theory, involving convection and the release of latent heat caused by the condensation of water vapor higher in the atmosphere, was much more sound. But he applied it too broadly, and let it lead him down the wrong path with respect to the behavior of storm winds. His centripetal theory, that all winds blow straight inward in a storm, has died a merciful death. The squabbling between Redfield and Espy seems to have prevented each from appreciating the other's insight. But the conflict turned as much on methodology as personalities. Redfield was a data guy, a perceptive observer who'd seen a pattern in the arrangement of winds and fallen trees and extrapolated from there. Espy also gathered data, pushed for the formation of weather observation systems, and experimented with the properties of gases on a small scale. But ultimately, he was a theoretician who sought the grandest of generalizations. To explain storms based on the behavior of the tiny molecules that comprise them. The struggle over these two disparate views of how to conduct research was further aggravated by the contrast between Redfield's status as a scientific amateur and Espy's popularity and institutional support. As Espy became increasingly sought after as a lecturer on storms, Redfield looked on with jealousy and resentment. Matters came to a head in 1849 when Espy, in his official capacity, submitted a report to the Navy Department that debunked the rotational theory of storms. Redfield objected that it was inappropriate for the Navy to lend the official endorsement by government to Espy's theory. He also added that the Navy's behavior was downright dangerous. Espy's mistaken understanding of storms could pose deadly risks to mariners who might come in contact with them. Redfield's complaint parallels more recent protestations, from those such as Carey Emanuel, that in 2005, amidst unprecedented storm destruction, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration inappropriately took sides on the question of whether hurricanes had been amplified by global warming. As they battled for scientific primacy, Espy and Redfield sought more data, more observations, to advance their respective positions. To fully resolve the issue, however, both empirical and theoretical approaches, bringing to bear as many disparate elements of the scientific toolkit as possible, would be needed. On the data side, the Yale-trained, Ohio-based meteorologist Elias Loomis, another Baconian in his scientific outlook, made an early stab at settling the budding storm controversy. First, Loomis tried to do so by intensively studying an individual winter storm system. He later turned to statistical studies of large groups of storms. Loomis saw the importance of taking many simultaneous observations of a single storm from different locations, so as to discern its full scale and direction of movement. In the course of his research, he published an early example of what is now known as a synoptic chart or weather map, drawing simple lines, known as isobars and isotherms, to connect regions with similar measurements for air pressure and temperature, accompanied by arrows for wind direction, and shading to denote different forms of precipitation. Loomis thus helped set the stage both for the modern systematic collection of meteorological observations and for the use of these observations in map-based weather forecasting by scientists like William Gray, a synoptically trained forecaster and another meteorological empiricist in the Redfield-Loomis tradition. By its very nature, the synoptical approach allows forecasters to favor the practical over the theoretical. One can learn to use a weather map without mastering all of the physical equations that govern the atmosphere. In fact, the lack of such mastery may even be an asset. As George Bliss, a meteorologist with the U.S. Weather Bureau, put it in 1917, in order to excel in the profession, one must possess a special faculty for intuitively and quickly weighing the forces indicated on the weather map and calculating the result. This special faculty is developed by long and continued study and association with the maps, rather than by a profound study of atmospheric physics. Loomis helped set this tradition in motion. It would require another ESPY-style theoretician, however, to resolve the storm controversy's central point of contention. In character, William Ferrell seems to have been a rather shy man, much more so than either ESPY or Redfield. Born in rural Pennsylvania and working as a schoolteacher in Tennessee when he made his key breakthrough, Ferrell excelled at mathematics. Studying the works of Isaac Newton and the Frenchman Pierre-Simon Laplace, famous for his work on celestial mechanics, Ferrell began to take an interest in meteorology. Before long, he had managed to explain how the Earth's rotation, from west to east, or counterclockwise if you're looking down on the planet from above the North Pole, influences not only the general circulation of the atmosphere, but also the rotational shape of storms. Ferrell has been described as the first true dynamical meteorologist, a scientist who successfully reduced the behavior of the atmosphere to the laws of physics and thus to equations. A French scientist, Gaspard Gustave de Coriolis, had noted in 1835 that because of the planet's rotation, objects in motion are subject to a certain force, now known as the Coriolis force, that deflects their trajectory. Coriolis did not discuss atmospheric motions, however, and his work wasn't widely known until much later. But Ferrell recognized that the Earth's rotation deflects winds, to the right in the northern hemisphere, and to the left in the southern, as he put it. This includes the winds of hurricanes as well as those of extratropical cyclones. Like most other scientists of the time, Ferrell did not draw firm distinctions between these two storm species. Picture a hurricane in the northern hemisphere, its winds flowing inward toward a central region of low pressure, which has been created by the rising of warm air. Without the Coriolis force, the winds would blow straight into the storm's center along a gradient from higher to lower pressure, perfectly conforming to ESPY's theory. But the winds don't do that. Instead, they deflect to the right due to the Earth's rotation. Just as an apple core thrown from the window of a car driving counterclockwise around a traffic circle will also veer to the right as it travels through the air, from the perspective of someone riding in the car anyway, as viewed by someone suspended in the air above, the core would appear to follow a straight trajectory. In effect, the hurricane's winds experience an array of different forces upon them. A pull inward due to the gradient in pressure, a deflection to the right due to the rotation of the Earth, and a centrifugal acceleration outward. These forces are nearly in what scientists call gradient balance, although that balance is upset slightly by friction from the sea surface. Because of the combination of the different forces, winds in northern hemisphere hurricanes spiral counterclockwise around a calm area, the eye, in the storm center. In the southern hemisphere, it's the opposite. Winds rush inward due to a differential in pressure, but also get deflected to the left, and the combination of forces acting upon them results in a clockwise spiral. To help conceptualize why cyclonic rotation reverses at the equator, you can perform a simple experiment. Sit at a table across from your friend and roll a cylindrical object, like a soda can, across the table from your left to your right, your friend's right to left. You will perceive a clockwise rotation, but your friend will perceive a counterclockwise one. It's the same with the planet Earth. Although contrary to popular misconceptions, the Coriolis force does not determine which direction water spirals when a toilet flushes or a sink drains. The Earth's rotation certainly influences the trajectories of winds, ocean currents, and airline flights, but at the tiny scale of a kitchen or bathroom, the Coriolis force is too minuscule to have a significant effect. Farrell recognized that the rotating Earth explains not only why cyclonic storms rotate in different directions in different hemispheres, but also why they never form at or very near to the equator, much less cross it and reverse their rotation. At the equator, the Coriolis force equals zero, making it the only place on Earth where Espy's theory actually holds true, where winds do rush straight inward toward low-pressure regions without being deflected. And so Farrell finally explained why Redfield had been right about the rotational nature of storms, despite Espy's powerful theory, which Farrell himself endorsed in a modified form and helped to develop further in later years, about convection and the release of latent heat. Farrell had resolved the American storm controversy and provided a dramatic new perspective on the nature of rotary storms, such as hurricanes. Scientists wedded to pet theories they've spent a lifetime developing and defending can have a hard time changing their minds, however. The novelist, Arthur C. Clarke, captured this inertia in what he called his first law. When a distinguished but elderly scientist states that something is possible, he is almost certainly right. When he states that something is impossible, he is very probably wrong. That aptly describes the aging James Espy, who late in life reviewed and criticized one of Farrell's early works, and who clung to his centripetal winds theory to the end. His views were positive, and his conclusions absolute, and so was the expression of them, one of Espy's contemporaries remarked after his death in 1860. He was not prone to examine and re-examine premises and conclusions, but considered what had once been passed upon by his judgment as finally settled. William Redfield died in 1857, without ever knowing of Farrell's work. "In my beginning is my end," T.S. Eliot wrote. Something similar could be said of meteorology. The American storm controversy had been fueled by personal and methodological tensions that find many parallels in today's hurricane climate debate. One can hear echoes of Redfield and Loomis in Colorado State University's empiricist and global warming skeptic William Gray, and detect further similarities between Espy, Farrell, and Carrie Emanuel. The empirical and theoretical, or dynamicist, camps in meteorology had already become well-defined and begun to diverge well over a century ago. More knowledge would have to accumulate, however, before scientists could conceivably clash over hurricanes and global warming. The greenhouse effect itself had hardly been conceived of, and despite 19th-century insights into the nature of hurricanes by empiricists and theoreticians alike, huge gaps in understanding persisted. Well into the 20th century, in fact, many commentators still thought of hurricanes as meteorological midgets whose storm column extended no more than a few kilometers from the sea surface up into the air. By contrast, it's now known that hurricanes can extend up through the entire weather-containing layer of the atmosphere, known as the troposphere. The strongest can stretch past the tropopause, the troposphere's top layer, and into the lower part of the Earth's stratosphere, reaching heights of 10 miles or more. Modern hurricane science took a long time to get organized for many reasons. One was the general misapplication of Espy's thermal theory of cyclones. It was most centrally used to explain not hurricanes, but wintry extratropical cyclones, which are far more common than hurricanes over the landmass of the United States and especially Europe, and whose strongest winds occur many miles up in the atmosphere rather than near the Earth's surface. This general failure to distinguish between types of cyclones severely hobbled the thermal or convective theory, and set the stage for its decline after the 19th century, as scientists increasingly doubted that latent heat release could explain extratropical cyclone dynamics. During World War I, a meteorologist named Wilhelm Bjerknes gathered together a talented group of young scientists in Norway to form what became known as the Bergen School of Meteorology. The Bergen scientists pioneered the alternative polar front theory of cyclones, attributing winter storms to the interaction of cold and warm air masses along fronts. In their view, the temperature contrast itself was the source of their power. Cyclones, concluded two young Bergen scientists in a famous 1921 paper, may be said to be links in the interchange of air between the polar regions and the equatorial zone. Extratropical cyclones also feature the release of latent heat, as cold air drives warmer air aloft, triggering condensation. But it's not the primary source of their power. The ideas of Espy, Farrell, and the other thermodynamic storm theorists were thus found inadequate to explain extratropical storms, even as most meteorologists focus their attention and energies upon them. Logistical and practical factors also contributed to the neglect of hurricane science. Instead of forming over land, these storms form over remote tropical oceans, where scientific observations were scarce throughout the 19th century and well into the 20th. The hurricane that strikes a populated area is a relatively rare occurrence. Before the availability of radar and satellite observations, it's likely that many hurricanes that never made landfall were never observed at all. During a time when observation often meant little more than being encountered by a seagoing vessel that managed to stay afloat and tell the tale. So it's no surprise that most meteorologists paid more attention to observing and analyzing daily weather than to studying distant extremes. Finally, the 19th century understanding of hurricanes didn't translate very well into the ability to predict their behavior or to respond to them, except perhaps among the mariners who grasped Pittington's Law of Storms. That became tragically clear right at the turn of the century, when a powerful hurricane obliterated Galveston, Texas, killing more than 8,000 people, who appear to have gone unwarned, with a 15-foot storm surge. Present-day analyses suggest the storm may have intensified just before landfall, which would have dramatically increased its destructive impact. Either way, the Galveston strike remains the deadliest natural disaster in American history. Before it sustained a direct hit from the 1900 hurricane, which was likely a Category 4 storm on the modern-day Saffir-Simpson scale, Galveston had been a thriving port city. It has never fully recovered. Galveston proved the need for a much better scientific understanding of hurricanes. World War II, which led to a dramatic buildup of the institution of meteorological science, helped supply it. The war, and the new technologies that sprang from it, greatly accelerated scientific study of weather, the atmosphere, and the oceans. Hurricanes and typhoons became less mysterious and easier to track and predict, but the new discoveries did not lead to a seamless merger between empirically oriented meteorologists and more theoretical ones. Instead, the war and post-war era gave scientists of both broad persuasions better tools for studying storms: radar, satellites, balloon-borne measuring devices, and even storm-flying airplanes for the empiricists and complicated computer simulations for the math whiz theoreticians, who also relied upon the influx of new data to gear up or initialize their computer models. The two most long-standing disputants in the hurricane global warming conflagration, Gray and Emmanuel, were themselves trained by two scientists who stood at the forefronts of these two trajectories of research. Gray's major professor, as he puts it, was the empiricist Herbert Reel, Herbie, as friends and colleagues called him, who is now widely recognized as the founder of the field of tropical meteorology. Emmanuel, meanwhile, studied under theoretician and computer model pioneer Jule Gregory Charney in the late 1970s at MIT. In fact, during the 1950s and 1960s, Reel and Charney themselves proposed divergent interpretations of hurricanes. Reel and Charney did not fight over their theories with anything approaching the hostility exhibited in the earlier American storm controversy, or for that matter, the animosity sometimes exhibited by the global warming hurricane combatants of today. Neither was an absolutist about methodology. Yet the contrasting interpretations of hurricanes that they advanced were deeply grounded in different approaches to scientific research. Reel's understanding, the heat engine theory, grew out of his empirical investigations, including a large number of research flights into hurricanes. Charney's theory, referred to as conditional instability of the second kind, or CISK, was unmistakably the product of a meteorological theoretician. Real and Charney both also brought us closer to entertaining the possibility that hurricanes might grow stronger because of global warming. Real's description of hurricanes as heat engines envisioned them as reliant upon ocean heat as their central power source. And in a warmer world, ocean heat is bound to increase. Charney, meanwhile, studied and supported the possibility that human beings might cause global climate change, including a warming of the world's oceans, through relentless industrial emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases. This leading advocate of the use of computer simulations to predict short-range weather also pronounced that long-range global climate models, commonly referred to as GCMs, were essentially sound in their basic findings. These are the models used today to project how emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases will change global climate. And their results suggest that the planetary experiment we're now undertaking could leave us with a radically different Earth in the space of less than a century. Chapter 2 of Heat Engines. The rain was torrential, Herbie Real would later recall, as the U.S. Navy reconnaissance plane penetrated a tropical depression to the south of Guam on August 29, 1947. In the Northwest Pacific Ocean Basin, which produces the most intense tropical cyclones on Earth, this storm's winds of 30 to 35 miles per hour were hardly remarkable. But in the context of Real's current research, they didn't have to be. The 32-year-old hurricane scientist, a German expatriate who liked to smoke cigars and play bridge and climb mountains, and who was sometimes a bit hard to get along with, had traveled to Guam along with several other University of Chicago meteorologists seeking to unravel the process by which typhoons form. This weak depression would teach Real a great deal about just how knotty and complex that problem truly is. In the opinion of the naval orologist on board the plane, who'd flown into many past Pacific storms, the rainfall in the depression seemed just as intense as what's found in a full-blown typhoon. So, Real expected such a storm to spin up shortly. But nothing happened, and the depression slowly meandered westward, unchanged, all the way to the China Sea. Real had witnessed an enigma that confronts every hurricane forecaster. Not every storm with the apparent potential to do so grows into a hurricane or typhoon. And not even the best forecasters can always predict which will and which won't. To Real, the experience of flying into this weak but very rainy depression had an important implication. Condensation energy alone cannot create intense tropical storms, he wrote. Instead, the release of latent heat, leading to clouds and rainfall, constituted a necessary but not sufficient condition for both inception and growth of tropical cyclones. It was just one of many important insights to arise from Real's eagerness to fly on board mid-century military planes and survey hurricanes from the inside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.